Hello and welcome to Daily Politics on Trust TV. On this program, we discuss issues around politics, policy and governance. I am Shabir Suleiman, standing in for Hamza Idris. The Senate has confirmed the appointment of Mr. Ola Olukoede and Muhammad Hassan Hamad Joda as the chairman and secretary, respectively, of the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC. The Red Chamber also confirmed the appointments of Mrs. Halima Shehu as the National Coordinator and the Chief Executive Officer of the National Social Investment Programme Agency, NSIP. They were confirmed following their screening on the floor of the Senate during Wednesday's plenary. Also, the Minister of Information and National Orientation, Muhammad Idris, has said that the administration of President Bola Tinubu is committed to providing an enabling environment for the press to carry out its vital role in the society. Speaking to State House correspondent after a meeting with the president at the presidential villa in Abuja on Wednesday, the minister said this administration has no intention of restricting the press, but press freedom must also come with responsibility. Idris emphasized that press freedom should be exercised in a manner that upholds ethical standards and promotes responsible reporting.
He has given me a mandate of what to do. I went, saw the sectional heads of the ministry, went around all the 8 agencies under the Minister of Information and National Orientation, and I went to charge them with the responsibility that Mr. President has given us to reset that sector, to make it more functional, so that once again we will have a very vibrant Ministry of Information and National Orientation. You know that this is a very delicate line to toe. While government and Mr. President and all of us in that sector are committed to ensuring that there is press freedom, that freedom, like I said, comes with responsibility. A lot of things that some of these people in the social media are doing is also not very patriotic. Sometimes you say news that is not factual. But I don't want a situation where it will be seen that government is trying to gag the press. I want that to be underscored. There is no attempt by government to gag the press. We are going to do whatever it takes that is responsible, that is also accountable. Responsible journalism is the way to go.
Tonight's program will focus on the issues ahead of the off-cycle election in Imo, Kogi, Bayelsa, and subsequently Edo State in 2024. Experts are of the opinion that the electoral umpire now has the burden of regaining the trust of the electorate, especially as there are insinuations that some Nigerians who have now lost confidence in the INEC following what transpired in the conduct of the 2023 general elections. Now, listen to this.
Well, the trust deficit is as a result of an inaction that was done in the last general election. So I think if INEC can actually do its best to ensure that those things that were not done in the last general election are done to the maximum for this general, for this off-cycle election, then it becomes easier for them to actually build trust. So I think that's an important part. So those things that were not done before should be done now, just to ensure that trust deficit can actually be built. My major concerns regarding the off-cycle election actually primarily would be that what is INEC's position in terms of curbing the security issues that we actually got in the last general elections, and also the issue of the BVAS also has to actually come to bear here, because that's actually the most important part of the election. So transmission of results has to be non-negotiable, and INEC has to ensure that it adheres strictly to the guidelines that it actually developed for itself, because it's now that they are actually arguing in court that guidelines that they set are not legally binding. It's something that sort of sets some level of double jeopardy system in the entire electioneering process. So I'm hoping that INEC can actually do their bits to ensure that the guidelines are adhered to very strictly. That's actually one of my concerns. But my primary concern would be what INEC intends to do as it regards insecurity currently, because the states that are going to be having their elections by November 11th are some of the most precarious state when it comes to security. Kogi State is very, very notorious for that. Edo is a bit tricky on its own, and then you go down east. So it's a bit, I think we need to, the commission itself needs to actually sit up and see how they can work better with security agencies and ensure maximum output and outcome for the entire process.
If INEC can be fair and make sure that Beavers work, that will make the election more transparent. They need to redeem their image. Imo election, Kogi and Bayelsa. The INEC chairman and his team, they have to do their best to correct the bad image not only in Nigeria, the international communities have had against them. So they need to do the needful. Irrespective of anything, they have to make sure that the people's vote counts.
We are now joined in the studio by Paul James. He is the program manager elections at Yaga Africa, and he joins us this evening to share his perspectives on these topical issues. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for the invitation.
Right. Before we commence the program, I would want us to perhaps take a look at some of those tidbits. Let's first start with the, but very briefly, so that we don't take the essence of our conversation, the appointment of leadership of the EFCC. Mm-hmm. What do you make up with this? You know, the issues surrounding the removal, if you like, mm-hmm. or voluntary resignation of mm-hmm. the EFCC chairman, and the modality, if you like, or the approach to the appointment of the new leadership.
I think so much was shrouded in some misery regarding how the president went about it, especially around the removal first. First, there is this understanding that whilst the nomination was made by the president, the confirmation was made by the Senate, and constitutionally, this should have also followed through the same constitutional process before the former EFCC chairman was removed. As it stands, nobody even knows what is the state of the former chairman. Yeah, whatever had happened to him.
And this was just told that he voluntarily resigned.
As far as we are concerned, we can say that he is incarcerated because we don't even know where he is. There has been no formal communication from him or even from the presidency. I mean, if he had voluntarily resigned, you also would have expected that you would see some sort of communication even from him or even from his whoever is helping to manage his communication. But that hasn't happened. But again, to the current appointment, we also have seen the sort of public reaction that had followed that appointment, especially around experience. There's already an act that establishes also specified what should be the modality for the appointment. You expect, for instance, that someone with experience that has also served through the commission for at least 15 years or thereabout, someone would also that has some background in security. But I think that is also what concerns a lot of persons have raised. I mean, granted, the current person that is appointment has served some years in EFCC and had understood the processes in the EFCC. What especially people from the legal background have been questioning is around the legality of that appointment. Has he served the statutory legal years of 15 years before appointment? Is he also someone from the legal background and all of that? So, I mean, a big question for the president to handle, presidency to answer, especially when you begin to see how some persons are beginning to look at most of the recent appointment with some lenses, regional lenses. Like if you look at most of the top level appointment that had happened in recent time and where, those sort of coming from a particular region. Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So people have their own reasons why they will raise eyebrows about this appointment. But what is very important for me is if the president is very upfront and very honest with Nigerians, he begin to share or tell Nigerians the reason as to why these sort of appointments are made, perhaps it will help to douse the tension that we are seeing in the polity.
Now, to sum that up, you know, both the removal, if you like, and the appointment, what do they say about our democratic practice? Are we really in democracy or sort of, you know?
I think it's so much so about how the structure of our constitution and the sort of power that it gives the president. Of course, the president has the power to appoint, but if you also follow the constitution, I understand that there is a process to it, that the National Assembly has to also ratify some of this appointment. But what I'm most concerned about is also what might be maybe abuse of power or abuse of privilege, especially when the president will think that he can always hire or fire. Without following what should have been the due process. Because my thought process will have been that this should have also have followed the channel of going back to the National Assembly to state why the president will want the person to be removed, and also giving those people that have been removed. A fair hearing to even understand what were the circumstances surrounding why they are removed from the office, or what would have been those things, or whatever would have been the allegation about.
If there are any.
There are any.
Because there is enough time, enough window to show for all of that if actually there is something to.
Exactly.
Okay, let's look at another very striking issue, the need to regulate, if you like, or the need for a responsible journalism. And of course, the fear of government on the abuse of also privileges and professionalism, you know. They need to strike a balance between this. Yes, the government is being accused of trying to gag the press, but it said, no, we're not interested in gagging the press. What we're trying to do is to ensure that there is responsible journalism. So how do we strike a balance here?
I think for me is, so much of this is happening because we still are grappling with concerns around trust issues, especially around government policies. The citizen will always want to question whatever the government comes up with because of the experiences of the past. Why are we having this conversation around gagging the press now? It's because of some of the things that, some emerging concerns in the polity, things around sensitive issues even around the presidency, the identity of the president and all of that. So begin to come up with ideas around regulating how some of these things are communicated. It will raise this sort of public sentiment. It is understandable. But I also don't think that may not have been a good time. I would have advocated for, maybe that should have been a perfect time to make this sort of pronouncement or communication. Thought the presidency or whoever are the handlers of this should also have been circumspect to sort of
look at the atmosphere, looking at issues around legitimacy, around identity, crisis, and so on.
Before they make such pronouncement. But of course, I also like the fact that if you talk about the balance, that there is always a pushback, especially there is a demand side from the government and from the people. Whenever the government want to push down, there's always that pushback. And I think that is where that balancing act comes in. And it's whether or not the presidency will listen or the government will listen to the people, because it's one thing also for them to make. Sometimes when you see such comments in the politics, I feel like it is more like to test the waters. If there is not much reaction, then we'll go ahead and do whatever we want, because we have seen that in the past. There have been different attempts in the past, not necessarily to even gag the press, but to even regulate communication, if you like, social media and the like. So we saw pushback in the past, especially from young people around when the government wanted to regulate social media. So I'm also hopeful or expecting that colleagues from the media will also push back, because you have to have this media freedom. It's a constitutional right, and it is when you have this, for me, that allows that freedom for people to even hold the government to account.
That's right. Okay, away from all of this, let's look at our talking point, you know, looking at the regaining trust of the electoral umpire, that is INEC, the issue around trust deficit and so on. Now, looking at the 2023 election, it came with a lot of concerns, you know, from the presidential election to other round of elections, governorship, state assembly, and so on. Now, the statistics, you know, if it is something to go by, is indicating that 1,280 political offices were contested in the 2023 election. This comprises one that is for the president, 109 for members of the Senate, 360 for the House of Representatives, 782 House of Assembly seats, and across that is across the 36 states of the 28 states rather of the federation. Then we have the 28 governorship elections. All of these elections were almost all of them were contested. That is 1,209 out of 1,280 mm-hmm. elections were contested. That is, if you look at the margin, less than 100 mm-hmm. were not contested. Mm-hmm. Significantly, almost all the elections were contested by, you know, in the court of law. What does this say about the integrity, the electoral integrity, or the integrity of the process generally?
I think we also have to first consider the nature of this contestation. Mm. And I mean, why some of these persons went to court. Mm. Some went to court regarding the outcome of the election. And so, I mean, a lot of things happened around the election, and witnesses stated people going to court. And I mean, it is within their right to do that, and also within the right of also people that are raising concerns now to put it at the doorstep of the Electoral Commission, because so much was expected before the election. But then before I go into the conversation arriving what happened around the election is to talk about the nature of political contestation in the country. Okay. Politics is so much about just grabbing power in this country, and we also know how people use the power once they get into office. Mm. For some persons,
not necessarily about service.
No, no. Most people get into this and are not even prepared for it. Mm. I mean, there are a lot of policy somersaults that you see now. You begin to wonder. We have we have states, for instance, that will start some white elephant projects. Mm. You see states that are not. It's not even economically viable.
Doing things coming like, up with them.
Airport.
Billions of taxpayers' money wasted.
There is a state that is currently in the news that has spent over $84 million US dollars to erect an airport that at the moment is comatose. It's nothing is even happening in this
state. You can imagine what that would have done if perhaps look at the priority areas.
And so you begin to think whether even the people that are aspiring to go into this even understand the priorities of this, what are even the needs of the people. So most times it's just about let's get into office. And for some persons, actually getting into the office is just to escape whatever will have been the issues they have with the society or with the policy. Mm. For instance, immunity.
I don't want to talk about how he, you know, using his election as an analogy, mm-hmm. saying that, you know, how he get escape poverty. So can you imagine?
Some is escape route for poverty. Right. Some is escape route for security agencies. Some is from the financial, economic and financial commission, if they're after them. Once they are there and they know they have some level of leverage or immunity, they know for the next 4 years at least.
Yeah, they are no longer going to be guests of security agencies.
Exactly, they are in some sort of safe zone. But the point is, if you look around why all of these things is happening, and like I always will say, there is no even readiness in the first place to even participate. At all means, let's get into power. Some don't even care about the process, it's just about the outcome. And so they get in, things happen, they go back, they go to the court because also another story for another day, because also how our judicial process have been bastardized in the country, that sometimes it's more like whoever gets there first will think they will have an upper hand at the end of the day.
And so anything can happen. You may lose at the lower court and then you gain
go to the next level.
So it's vice versa.
It's very troubling that this is happening, but if you situate all of this around the electoral context, there was so much expectation for the Election Commission going into the election. Yeah. A lot of promises were made, especially from the Commission, that to some extent were not met. This was the election that was predicated on the use of technology.
Especially around the transmission of results.
Exactly. This was also the election that to some extent, the election that for the first time we thought there would be some respite with the new electoral act that we have.
I was actually coming to that.
Yeah.
Because if for instance, we are unable to get it right, or there hasn't been substantial progress or improvement in the electoral process and the outcome, what does it say about, you know, the much energy that was dissipated and time that was wasted in putting together the new electoral act?
Well, even on the, I want to take it a step further. First is even about the Electoral Commission.
Yes, sir.
Because for me, that is where everything rests. The Constitution gave them power to manage election. The Electoral Act for that support that and all of that. I know if you put it at their doorstep, the Commission will throw it back to us and said, if you look at the people that manage the elections, they are Nigerians. Which might be true, because if you think about the staff strength of the Commission and then the number of persons that they deployed for the election, over 176,000 polling units, each of these polling units will have four of the INEC staff. And so most of these were ad hoc staff that to some extent the Commission didn't even have control around. Besides throwing up a portal for people to apply, sometimes
at
ad hoc level, you don't have control around their credibility and all of that, but it still rests at the doorstep of the Commission, because there are some things that had happened during the conduct of the election that we thought if the Commission had stepped in, that we would have had less of this friction that is happening. Now, for instance, so, number one is around communication. Number two is around application of its own guidelines, application of its rule. If I break it further, is to, for instance, if you think about the outcome of the election, if you think about the March 18 election and why we have supplementary election in some locations, is because of the inability of the Commission to have the same rule across every election. You have an election in Adamawa State that finished on the first ballot but had to go for supplementary because of the difference between the people that had between PVCs and the difference between two people and two of the major contenders. 31,000 difference between the two contenders, about 37 PVCs collected in those locations. So the Commission had
There are some issues that are still reverberating at the court, you know, the legal processes now.
Let me just land on this. Like the inconsistencies you see there and why definitely some persons will go to court. In the case of Adamawa, for instance, that was the basis about which the Commission decided to go for supplementary. But you got states like Kaduna where the difference was about 10,000. And then the Commission declared the winner. You got state like Ogun State, the difference was 19,000, the Commission declared the winner. Or state like Enugu State, difference of about 3,000, and the Commission declared the winner. Of course, anybody in his right senses will think, if you had gone for supplementary in a state like Adamawa that had 31,000, why won't you go for supplementary in this state? Any right-thinking person will want to go and argue their case in the court. And part of that is why we're seeing the proliferation of all of these court cases.
And by the way, you have the same rules applied.
Exactly.
Why inconsistency in application?
The same rule on paper, but on application, problematic. Because if you also take the body posture, the body posture of the Commission, in some instance, it was more like, let us just go through these processes and then, in fact, the Commission chair was, people heard the Commission chair when he also advised aggrieved people to go to court, for instance. Is that the last resort?
Actually, I'm actually coming.
I'm sorry to cut you. By the new Electoral Act, the Commission have a window of 7 days to review election that is challenged, election that they think they have concerns with. This is what the new act has done to the Commission. In the past, once a declaration is made at the polling unit, the only solution to it is to go to court. Now the Commission has 7 days to review elections that are conducted under questionable circumstances. Why didn't the Commission apply this in any of this election that had happened? That is the question.
And it has also the right to reverse where it found out that there are established
very
breaches.
Very clear. The rule, the law is clear about that.
Right. Because what is happening now is like people are beginning to take it as a norm that, by the way, you can also win election in court, not necessarily through the ballot.
I don't think it's even that is the new. Sadly, that's exactly the feelings out there now. That don't rejoice when elections are counted at the polling unit. Wait until you hear from the court. And it is sad that we are at this level.
If the chairman of the commission will tell you that okay, if you agree, go to court and things like that, it gives room to suspect exactly. that, okay, some things have been done.
In fact, I will tell you, I know, I mean, you also are looking at the coming elections. If there is something that is happening in some of these states, based on my interaction, I have been to the states for our pre-election engagement. The feelings you get from the state, you get this lethargy from the people, you get this feeling of despondency, this apathy, because some person still feel still having this feeling like to what end. And then from the experience of the past, there are places where the commission had conducted election that it was somewhat like the commission was in a rush, in a hurry to just finish the election. We have it on record in the 2019 elections in Bayelsa State. I was on ground in Bayelsa. They were it is a state that is riverine, 70% or more on water. Now, there is this saying in the state that he who controls the water have the election. And you know what that means?
Seriously.
Negatively, any of the bad elements that controls the water have the election. In that election, the commission staff were kidnapped.
Yeah.
Materials were hijacked.
Yeah.
I mean, it's common knowledge that this problem exists.
That's right.
It's to come out.
It should be proper planning as to how.
And even communicate, manage expectations.
That's right.
I can tell you at Yaga, we documented that election didn't happen in 24% of the locations where we deployed observers. But returns were made in some of these locations. So how do you talk about building people confidence in that?
Then
I was at an event with a high-ranking official from the state just after the election, where he was all excited that he even fasted for 2 weeks and the election went well. I said, no. It wasn't true. That was actually, in a long time in the history of election in the state, that was the first time that election will happen and end on the first ballot. I said, but that wasn't true, because you as a commission was in a rush to finish that election. And we saw how it ended.
Okay, deducting from some of the issues you raised here, it's obvious that there are a number of challenges, you know, from human challenges to logistic challenges, and so on and so forth. But in the 2023 election, a lot of expectations were raised, you know. Built around the reforms, you know, so to speak. Substantially, INEC will say, yes, we had logistic issues, you know, the VBAS, the, what do you call it now, the IREB and the rest of it did not function optimally. That's logistic, so to speak. But what happened to the plans, you know, the plan B now, because if this one fails, perhaps you should resort to the manual processes. And so what happened to the manual processes?
Well, let me tell you what I saw in the 2023 election. There is so much crave around let us take the bus, that we conducted election on the day we set out to conduct election, because we have had histories of postponed elections, especially major elections in the country, in the 2011, 2015, and 2019. 2015, 2019, to a large extent, were around security. Now, if you look critically also around this election this time, there were some genuine reasons that would have led to the postponement of the election. The commission assets were attacked, the highest, over 53 times, the highest in the Southeast. Just even before the election.
The attacks on the server?
Not even server. When I say asset, I mean their facilities and all of that. The commission will keep assuring we are ready.
Including offices and so on.
Offices. Yeah. There were insecurity concerns also in some parts of the country. Yeah. The commission still assured that it was ready. Now, at Yaga, we went around the country to recruit observers who were in all of the 774 local governments. I can tell you there were places that we went to in about 9 states that some communities were ransacked, like people have deserted the community.
Election will not take place?
Yes. We came up with a long list of some of these places and the problems we discovered there. And we engage with the commission. What are the plans for these people? How do you plan to conduct the election? Right? At the end, the commission came up with a list of about 200 or thereabout locations where they will not conduct election. But the reason for that was because their voters were not allocated to polling units, not for security reasons. So there were those reasons before then. There was also, if you recall, the concern around some economy policy around cash.
Affected the cashless
election
policy.
Planning. Right. There are some plannings that the logistics that you do that are cash based, you can't run away from it.
Yeah, even though INEC said it has, I mean, that there was a collaboration between CBN and INEC to address some of those
there
issues.
There was. Did we have any, is there any accountability metrics? Has the commission come up at any point to tell Nigerians we got these resources? I can tell you it never happened because on the eve of the election for the presidential, in the FCT here, we went to the 6 INEC zonal area councils. We went there, we deployed people there to go ask questions. There are some places that complained they had not received resources yet, and then the ad hoc staff are complaining or are insisting that if we don't get some cash, we will not go out. Even some of the transporters, they wanted some of their payment in cash because then there was no cash anywhere.
That's
people
right.
were looking for every
available opportunity to
access
get cash.
So even the transporters insisted that until they get cash. So we knew on the eve of the election that there will be problem in the FCT, that there will be delay commencement of poll in the FCT. Yeah. Now, what is the thing? It's around communication, like I said, managing expectation. Yeah. There is nothing stopping the commission on the eve of that election to come up with a public statement. Due to ABC, we could have delay commencement of election. Not we are postponing.
Okay, around delay, not postponement,
yes,
because postponement
delay.
Is another issue.
It's another issue. Yeah. We could have delay. So because of this, these are also the plan B, just like you had asked. Plan B could be extend the time of voting.
Yeah.
Plan B could be, we are also in some location.
Creating alternative
to do election even on day two. Now, in the electoral guideline, by the commission, they had also planned that in locations where election didn't happen until 2 p.m., they will move the election to the following day. I can tell you also that we documented about 20 of our locations that were in our sample that the commission didn't go back on day two to conduct election.
So what happened? How was it concluded?
There was communication about INEC going back to do election in those locations, but the moment results started coming in, nothing happened. And that is why I said there was also on the rush. There was also a rush
yeah,
on the part
conclude,
of the commission to just conclude the process. They have 7 days to review.
Well,
if you recall, also on the first day of the at the collation center here at the International Conference Center, when the commission declared the place open. It was in the afternoon, around 1-2. Yeah. There was no single results that came in.
Yeah, well, they had to take a break. Yeah.
They took a break and waited until about 6 p.m. It is not, nobody is putting a gun on their head that it has to be that day.
Yeah.
If it is not ready on the Sunday, we can start on a Monday.
Perhaps they just want to commence the process.
Again,
even if
they have 7 days to review. But then at the moment they started coming in, even when the party agents there were raising concerns, the commission kept collating, and at some point they told the people that are aggrieved, go to court.
Quite unfortunate. And this is where we are now, with over 90% of this election outcome being contested in various courts across the country. And we're looking at how this can be addressed, because fundamentally it erodes, you know, the confidence, of public confidence in the electoral body, and again, also put drain resources, because we're talking about huge amount of money that is invested, you know, to carry on with these litigations. In case you're just joining us, the program is Daily Politics, and today we're looking at building electoral credibility, that is looking at INEC and the huge, you know, integrity, if you like, deficit that has generated from the outcome of the 2023 elections. And we've been interfacing with James from the Yaga Africa. We will take a break. When we return, we'll continue with the conversation. Stay with us.
There's a problem in Nigeria. Rising unemployment is leading to crime, death, and homelessness.
I graduated since 2020. There's no work. There's nothing.
With no jobs, no money, and no food, many young people are frustrated.
There are many young youth out there looking for what to do. But when you come to Nigeria, you will see old people doing the work that young people should do.
My own local government itself, we don't have anybody in this community that is working there.
Lost and forgotten in slums, the echoes of their worries haunt the seat of power. Where is their government?
This village is like we are inside the city, and our boys are running up and down, no work.
What is the truth behind Nigeria's unemployment statistic? Beyond the affluence of Abuja's wealthy 1% lies the grief of the 99% struggling to earn a living.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, this is Daily Politics on Trust TV. Do well to follow us across all our social platforms and watch us live on YouTube. And we're still discussing, the need to build confidence around the public, especially in respect to the electoral credibility of our country. Now we're looking at off-season elections, and the need to build this or address this trust deficit among Nigerians. And before the break, we're looking at some of those challenges. What led to where we were, or what happened, during the 2023 election? We've identified clearly that there are a number of challenges, from human factors to systemic factors and so on and so forth, logistics and the rest of it. But a lot of Nigerians will find it extremely difficult to understand what actually happened, because in 2015, for instance, the INEC, led by Mahmoud Jega, mm-hmm. Professor Tahiru Jega, mm-hmm. Only came up with what they call the technology then, the card reader.
Mm-hmm.
And substantially, card reader. And substantially, there was credibility. There was a lot of improvement in the credibility of the electoral process. In fact, to the extent that the outcome of the 2015 election was almost unchallenged.
Yeah.
Lawyers were, resting and everything. Mm-hmm. At some point, some say there was no market, mm-hmm. and all of that. Mm-hmm. Nothing was happening. Nigerians were happy. things actually went well.
Yeah.
But the 2020 subsequent elections, where there's huge investments in technology, mm-hmm. In manpower, in logistics, and yet we're having a reverse in terms of performance, in terms of outcome.
Yeah.
Why are we having this?
Well, I think what happened for me was, one, there was no clear plan around crisis management. Okay. Before the election, the commission had there was a supply of over 181 there about 1,000 of the beavers to be used nationwide. Mm. In January 2023, the commission deployed this equipment to the state offices, and they were supposed to do what they call a field test in the state to assess the readiness, connect them to network and all of that. Mm. That process was also not communicated to the public. Some of us were able to be privy to the information, and we deployed observers to go and observe the process. But we were able to assess that process in about 14 locations. I could tell you from January that we envisaged there could be problems. Some of those devices were not connecting to network. Some of them have failure with the systems, like power button not working, camera not working, and all of that.
Mm.
We approached the commission then, and we asked. The commission said, it is that routine internal process,
mm-hmm.
and they will rectify those issues before full deployment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in February 2023, on the 4th of February, to be precise, the commission conducted a mock accreditation, mm-hmm. across 316 centers nationwide.
Yeah.
This is in anticipation of conducting election in 176,000 polling units.
Mm.
And then you pick locations that are not even up to a percent of the locations. And of course, if you are conducting this sort of exercise, anybody in his right senses will cherry pick the best of materials to use.
Yes,
the systems work perfectly.
Will not give you the exact outcome. I mean,
yes,
you will not be able to get
the system worked perfectly in the mock accreditation. But the exercise was just 20 days before the election. Election day happened, right? To some extent, these devices worked for accreditation, but they didn't work for results upload. I expected at that point, for some person that began to see the thing from like 6 p.m., 7 p.m., that it wasn't working, they reached out to the commission. It took until around 10 or 11 before the commission came up with a communication and said, glitch.
There are glitches.
Up to today, you are talking about inspiring confidence, but up to this moment, you have not explained to Nigerians what was that glitch, whether that was an internal sabotage, who has been apprehended.
But they talk about the attacks, you know, on the server and all of that.
That is, as far as I'm concerned, English. That's English.
You think it's not connected?
I mean, the point here is, what sort of attack? Who have you apprehended to, if there was an attack?
And what was the where were the mechanism put in place to checkmate those attacks?
No, let us assume it even happened. And after a week, the server was up, you were able to do everything. What did you do that was different from what you did for the presidential? But the point I'm making it, right, I didn't expect, I'll be honest with you, that it will be 100% perfect.
Of course, considering perfect election.
No,
anyway.
Considering the number, the volume that was deployed, and for that it was happening for the first time. And that is why, again, I keep going back to the idea around communication, because if the commission had come up to tell Nigerians, this is what we intend to do, and we don't expect perfection. This is the first time that this will be done nationwide. There could be challenges, and then we'll begin to define what will be success rate. Maybe we could say if this was able to work even 50%. Also forget that is just supposed to be like a support to the results transmission process, because the transmission still remains that from the polling unit, there will be the forms will be completed, signed by an INEC official. A copy is given to party agents. So at least we have the paper trail. So there will have been that idea that the technology to be deployed is in support of that paper trail. We don't anticipate that it will work 100%, but we hope we'll perfect it before future election.
And there was a lot of confidence, you know, building and on the part of INEC before the election. A few days in the election, there has been a lot of confidence building, you know, assurances from INEC.
That's the point. That's what is annoying. Nigerians felt the trust was betrayed, because Nigerians trust INEC so much. When that upload started, oh my God, you needed to go and see some of the things that were uploaded. Some persons were uploading their selfie. And then there were...
You mean INEC staff?
INEC staff. Instead of uploading the result, they were uploading their selfie, their pictures. Some of the results that were uploaded were blood. In some instances, three results will be uploaded. But if you look at the environment around the upload, you realize that they are also looking similar. Does it mean that they brought all the results to one location to upload? Because we have the understanding that they should be uploaded from the polling unit level.
That's it.
That is what I said. The communication will have solved that. If we are expecting, for instance, if we are expecting internet challenge, we will move them to one location and upload. It is fine. Nigerians will trust you if you tell them that. Nobody will put a gun to your head. And then people began to raise concerns around, what we saw from the polling unit is different from what was uploaded. I expect the moment that is happening, INEC can come back to counter it. No, this is also what we have.
Again, looking at the process, there's this concern around, the legal issues now, looking at the framework. It is not binding, you know, like it is established during this litigation, that it is not binding on the INEC perhaps to restrict itself to the to the electoral processes. To the technological processes. You know, it can also look at what is obtainable and what is doable at the point in time to do, that is resorting to manual processes. And that was what they fall back on. What have you envisaged this, you know, in the electoral act? Because that's where they drive, perhaps.
I think these are all about semantic. If you go to the guideline, it is clear, it tells the commission what to do. Commission should use technology, any technological means possible, to upload polling unit level results. It talks about accreditation of voters, section 47 of the communication should use. What is not expressly clear is around electronic process of conducting the election. The process is manual, but there is the place for the commission to hold electronic copy of the register. There is a place for the commission to use electronic means to accredit voters. There is also the place for the commission to store the report. The argument for the commission is that it didn't say that they should do transfer of the granular data. And that is why what the commission was doing was to take a snapshot of the results and upload on the database. Fine, if that point is not clear, this is also why we have another chance at electoral reform, is to go back now and see how we can rejig the plan. I like the fact that you referenced the 2015 election and people, to some extent, there was acceptance of the credibility of the process, because everything was clear from the onset. Before we went into that election, there was a mock election that happened across almost every state.
That's right.
Just like we had now. But there was enough more communication around that election. Like I still remember,
the level of awareness.
I went to Nasarawa State to observe the process. There was level of awareness. Issues about the process were raised and were addressed before the election. In this election, people went for the mock accreditation and then realized, oh, I have been moved to another polling unit. How did the commission respond? They simply sent text messages to people on how to locate their polling unit. How many people got the text messages? Even if you received the text message, the process was to go online. How many of us are technologically savvy to know how to even apply themselves to go online and do the process?
Exactly. And then looking at awareness and the role of the electorate too, which is also fundamental. Talking about 2015 election, for instance, we've seen the level of enthusiasm, the level of interest that election generated. But again, the 2023 election also generated similar interest among Nigerians. But holding the electoral body accountable was also another thing entirely, because during the 2015, you could see that everywhere you go, or everywhere the chairman of the commission then, Professor Atahiru Jega, goes, he talks about one man, one vote. And then that resonated with the people, and people were like, my vote would have to count, you know. So, but in this case, I mean, in 2023, people relaxed, you know, perhaps because of the reforms, because of the assurances and so on. And then they resigned to fate, and then things degenerate.
Yeah, if you also think about the major players in this election, I think it is the voters, not even the other stakeholders. Major players in the sense, I see participation from the point even where people go to engage in the process of voter registration. If you recall, this is also an election where the process of registration has to be extended a couple of times because of the sort of interest that people showed in it. In fact, there was a public outreach that happened at the old parade ground here. I was at that outreach. In that outreach alone, over 18,000 Nigerians.
You could see the stampede and what have you, how people were.
Yes.
I mean,
in that location alone, over 18,000. Similar thing happened in Lagos, over 11,000 registered in that location.
Even though that also happens at the 11th hour, you know, Nigerians with that.
Yeah, but whatever it is, that also shows you the level of commitment on the part of Nigerians to participate. That process happened. After that, there was a process of the PVC collection and how it went, right? A lot of complaints came from there. It happened early January, around January 6th to January 15th. Some persons will tell you, oh, we went to the place, we couldn't find INEC staff. Some will tell you, we went to the place, INEC staff were showing us attitude. They just threw the thing at us to pick and we couldn't find our own. And there was no communication around how to get our PVCs. Now there are also a lot of PVCs that were lying fallow in INEC offices as of then, because there were concerns around even a database of these people. That was also the time where INEC decided to start doing something. They started collating database, and then it went viral. INEC didn't communicate to people that it was doing that so that they can send information to people about where to pick. Good intention, but bad communication around it. So they were able to harvest some of this information and send text to people. But before people could come and start the collection, time was short.
Right. Now that we have the off-season elections around the corner, I mean, what do you think need to be done very quickly by INEC to regain that public confidence?
Public communication. The commission has to be in the faces of the people. Like you mentioned around 2015, how Jega went about it. I was in Imo State. And the sense you get from Imo State is that there is a disconnect. We don't know what the commission is doing. When we invite them for event, they don't come and all of that. There is a disconnect, and the commission needs to disabuse, I mean, they need to go above that, above public sentiment. I remain professional
there
in
must
their
be
engagement.
Improvement in public engagement.
Improvement in public engagement. That's right. And then at every point, we should also be documenting and be celebrating progress. INEC will always come up with a 15-point of what they intend to do before election. So at every stage, let us document and celebrate progress. For instance, last week or so, they gave the register of voters to political parties. This should be something that is everywhere. People
That's
should
right.
know.
That's right.
Voter registration happened between the 9th of September to the 10th of October.
Yeah.
This is also what Nigerians should be celebrating. So
not just
point,
only election, you know.
Not just election. This thank election you. Is a process.
Yes, thank you very much, James, for your informed perspective on this topic. James is the program, Paul James is program manager elections at Yaga Africa. We appreciate your coming.
Thank you very
and
much.
And viewers, that's a wrap on today's package. We sincerely hope you found the conversation engaging and informative. And be sure to join Daily Politics Live, airing every weekday, and also a special package on Friday, during which we open our telephone line for you to comment on national issues. Once again, we thank you for watching. I'm Shapiro Suleiman.